Good afternoon from New York. I'm your personal political rational mystic. Put that together. Anyway, I've got a subject today. Mystics aren't good because they fear not to be. They are good because it feels good to be. Feels good to be good. Well, I'm going to take a little development, empathy. But once you are in your comfort zone with objectivity and compassion and creativity, and once you've expanded that a little, you know, you're going to be more truthful, more good, and more artful. And from that, you know, being in your comfort zone, that's a learning experience, and it will feel good. Just like exercise, after you get used to a certain routine and it's a healthy one, you know, you're comfortable with it and you want to do it. So you want to be those things when your comfort zone extends into those skills. And that's the path of the mystic. So more and more, as you take that path of the mystic, everybody's on the path, or could be. You're not doing things out of fear. You're not, you know, afraid of social hatred or whatever. I mean, as a, or some punishment. You know, you might be that, yes, but you're not being good because of it. You know that you're going to get a ticket if you run the red light, but you're not running the red light because you're fearful of a ticket. That's a pretty shallow virtue, to be doing the right thing because you're afraid. That's not the path of the mystic. The mystic doesn't look at it that way. Mystic does the right thing because they have an expanded sense of caring extended by their and aided by their objectivity, compassion, and creativity. And so you don't run the red light because you understand that it could end up with you harming other people or getting harmed yourself. So you don't, and that you feel very comfortable about that. You're not doing it because there's a stricture against it. You're doing it because it feels right. It feels right because it's in your comfort zone. You know, there's some people that was, you know, I had an ex who would say to me, she would say, I'd say, I've been thinking, and she'd say, did it hurt? Well, she was smarter than me in some ways, so yeah, I can see why she would say that. Yeah, when it's not in your comfort zone to be that objective, yeah, it could hurt. Yeah, it could be you're outside of your comfort zone. You're overly challenged, you know, you've been trying to run a 3-mile race and you're not able to do it, you know, and you're to the side of the road, and you know, so yeah, it can hurt. That's the thing that you have to realize, and that's one of the first things that I realize, that you know, the importance of these forms of empathy is that you have to move into a comfort zone with objectivity, creativity, and compassion. You say, well, with compassion, how is that not in your comfort zone? Well, you know, it takes energy to be compassionate, and especially, you know, to extend that compassion beyond yourself and your immediate family, or just your country, or maybe just one day, just this world. It takes energy to do that. And it just like it takes energy to exercise and to get used to and put that into your comfort zone. So, yeah, compassion too. To bring your concerns farther away from just yourself. Yeah, that takes some energy. And being asked to do more than that, you know, immediately is kind of pointless. People can't do those things. You know, you can't ask someone to run a 6-mile race if they can't run a two-yard dash or, or walk. Yeah, you got to consider that. And so, yeah, you know, a lot of times we demand that people, you know, change, you know, that they, you know, achieve these elements of virtue before they're ready, and that's not actually very compassionate. You need to take your time with them. You need to show them the path and help them to develop. And in so doing, you help to develop yourself. The mystic path is really something that it's not just all about one person, although that's the way it looks to a lot of people. You know, you're a mystic, so you're up on top of the mountain, and you don't have any association with anybody. You know, you're all into yourself. It's all your own, whole and complete within yourself. No. You know, not within your normal sense of self. You know, there's a sense of self that's larger, and you know, and that sense of self requires a higher virtue and higher, larger comfort zone with those skills and abilities. You can't, for instance, expect people to trust if they haven't, you know, grown in the comfort zone that entails all of these things that I mentioned. Those are the things that that enable you to be more trusting, because you know when and why and how to trust. And again, it's a skill, and it's kind of, trust is a kind of virtue, but it's there because of the other virtues, because you've grown in your objective, creative, and compassionate empathy. I hope I'm not going too fast with that. Remember, I've been thinking about these things for 40 years. And I'm not the best presenter. I'm not a professional teacher. Bless those who are. I hope that professional teachers will learn and practice this and do a better job than I'm doing. You know, that's always the hope of anybody who's working in any field. And yet, I have to say that this is its own field. It's not identical with, although it has a lot of overlap fields do overlap, of course, all fields of study. But this is a unique kind of field, and it should be just that, not a kowtowing to somebody who has arrived. That's kind of silly. In the first place, how do you know they arrived? But, you know, they can show you things, and, you know, and then as your trust will grow, as you say, oh, they were right about that, you know, I tried this and this happened, and, you know, this is the way that goes. And then, you know, as you gain greater trust in your teacher, then, yeah, you can, you know, honor thy father, thy mother, and you know, thy grandparents, you know, honor your teacher. You know, and there's a kind of love relationship there. Mentors need to be worthy of their hire, but they also need to receive the help that they need to continue helping. But when you see somebody that's, you know, asking for all your money and you're not seeing that money do anything good, or it's just to help that teacher be in a fancy car and travel all around the world to spread the news. You don't need to travel all over the world to spread the news. You can put somebody else on a fancy plane, send them out to do it for you. I mean, if you're a good teacher, you should have good students, and they need training, and they need a chance to spread the message. So, you know, that's the way I see that. So, I mean, mystic isn't all about possessions or power. If you see somebody about that, then they're not a mystic. They're there, a very fledgling one. They haven't grown very much. You know. Some of this stuff naturally occurs as we get older. Prime time for real serious concern and taking up on the path. Well, 30s on up, but you know, some few are ready earlier than that. You know, to become very serious with the path, because you know you. A lot of younger people are very concerned about, and middle-aged people are very concerned about, they have a lot of concerns. They got their, in the middle-age position, you've got your adult children, sometimes that you're helping to finish growing up, and you've got your parents as well, who are on the decline, that are beginning to make an exit from this world, and you have to help them to self-actualize in their own way, and you know, honor them and their wisdom, but also take care of them, and that's a big strain. You know, to ask somebody even in their middle ages to embrace this, hey, let's give the grandparent age people a job. Mm-hmm. You know, people who are retired, you know, it's your time. It's, if you're retired and you've been growing in these ways anyhow, one way or another, pretty ready, and you should start learning these things at very early age, of course. You know, it's fairly early age. It's not a thing for children, you know, just be loving and kind to the children, and you know, that's a whole different picture. understanding of the mystic path. Yeah, maybe. And I'll leave it to the professional educators of children. What if any part of this should be imparted to little ones? But a serious practice of this whole thing, I mean, you know, you got to be at least, I think, in your 30s. Brain isn't fully developed, and, you know, until after 25 years of age, right? See how, you know, be an informed mystic, you know, learn from many sources. But yeah, I think I've explained why the growing mystic is let's put it on a sliding scale, tends to be motivated not by fear in terms of their virtues, but by real understanding, compassion, and and creativity that they are comfortable with. Yeah. And that builds up, this trust, this comfort zone, which is could be seen as another virtue, but it's dependent on the other virtues. And so, yeah. Faith, hope, and love. Yeah. You know, the faith, hope, and love part is every day in your drama development, your artfulness that appeal to the imaginer and your imaginations, that personification of the supreme reality, which you can only know through your brain, so let's just call it the brain. That part we know for sure. That higher power, that recognizing that is the beginning of the true mystic journey. When you realize that, and you embark on a process, a spiritual process, that brings you into a closer relationship with this personification of absolute truth and virtue. That part of you that's outside of your timeline can appreciate the entire story. Yeah, that is the beginning. Especially, you know, when someone gets to that point, yeah, they're pretty much doing things that are right, because they wouldn't be comfortable not to. It's in their comfort zone. It's a pleasure. It's a joy to do the right thing. Whereas doing things out of fear, well, maybe you begin life that way. But doing things out of fear alone is not a very sincere virtue. It's not an integrated virtue. It's something you do because it forces outside of yourself. So, the mystic, as I said, doesn't do things that are right or good because they fear not to. or they fear punishment. But because of the love flow, because they feel good when they do good. Like an athlete feels good when they exercise properly. They feel good. And that skill and that ability, it grows over time. I know. I didn't present it in a way that that is easy to follow, perhaps. Then again, maybe you're a lot smarter than me. You can put it together in spite of my limitations. Well, I like to say at the end of my presentations, Namaste, because it is an honoring of that potential and that marvelous, almost unimaginable wonder that every person is. It honors that. It's recognizing it in yourself and honoring it in the other person. So in a sense, honoring it both in yourself and in the other person. It's also a statement of we're together. So I would, before I say the magic word, which means all of that, that I believe in magic. But artfully, it's a nice thing to, kind of an effective way of giving. A spin and an attractive spin to something. So I'd like if you can to subscribe and share the video if you like it. If you don't, give me a down, if you like it, give me an up. I can't read everything that's there, and if you're just arguing for argument's sake, probably I'm not going to respond to you. If you have questions, I will respond. That's a nicer way of approaching a person who tries to teach, is to ask questions. You can ask them, how do you know this? Have you considered this other perspective? I'm giving you suggestions. Not just, you don't know as much as I do. I have this word and you don't have that word. I'm not going to play games. Not into it. I don't have the time for that. You misuse the word democracy. Someone said that to me, and democracy is used in the broad sense I was using it in, period. And then, go into the details of it, different ways of saying it. But look, if you want to converse with somebody, you don't come at them as an attack. You come at it trying to find common ground. That is the IMC way. Try to find the common ground and reason from there. Ask questions. And questions are a way of challenging ideas without being hateful toward another person. and look at it. It's more realistic. Your two brains communicating. You want to help the other brain and your brain. So don't go in with the idea that you know it all. And you have to have respect for the other person. Look for common ground. And make reason from there. You're not going to convert anybody by with attacks. Yeah, and if you're into that, go join the MAGA crowd. Okay, you know, not into that. Not going to tolerate it. I'm going to deal with it. It's not the way. And I don't want to exhaust myself or anybody else with that kind of thing. So are you attacking the MAGA by saying that? Bit guilty there. But what I'm trying to say, and I will say it clearly, is that the MAGA crowd tends to be needing a broader comfort zone. These skills seem to be a little bit not present. That doesn't mean these people are inferior to anybody else. It's just that they need to grow in those ways. And they need to grow in those ways sometimes before you can really communicate well with them. And that goes for me, you know. Someone can say, you're not as smart as Neil deGrasse Tyson. No, I'm not, you know. But if you want me to learn more, then, you know, just pound that home. It is, you know, Neil would try to break it down, right? Wouldn't he? He'd try to break it down, so see what I could understand. And he wouldn't be insulting me, telling me I'm using the wrong word. So, ridiculous. So, if you're going to communicate, I would appreciate that you communicate in a friendly way. And I will respond in kind. And if I'm wrong, then show me the real clear evidence, and you know, I'll take a look at it. Certainly will. But let's do it in questions, okay? Let's question one another and be kind. So, because remember, it's just a matter of nobody's fault. It's not my fault that I'm not as smart as Neil deGrasse Tyson. I have the brain I have, and I have to use it. Hopefully I'm using it well, you know, considering what I have. Yeah. And another point I want to make is that we are not our beliefs. A lot of what we do may come from our beliefs, but we're not those beliefs. And when someone challenges a belief we have, you know, with a question, with a polite way, that's an opportunity to grow. And it's not an attack on, you know, if someone says that to me, it's not an attack on me. Okay? Oh, and look at it. And, you know, instead of, if you're arguing with people, you just communicate with each other and put the beliefs out there and separate yourself from your beliefs. Just, this is a belief I have, not a belief I am. You know, and then communicate. And that's how, you know, with that kind of approach is how, you know, we do also expand our comfort zone and do things and say things out of love instead of fear and anger. All right? So that magic word is namaste. May the potential and the love flow and the wonder that is you be honored today. And I certainly honor that in you, that which lives in me and in you, whoever you are. Namaste. And have a good day, y'all.